Hello and welcome. My name is John Dickinson for Boris Effects, and in this particle illusion tutorial, we're going to continue with the controls window, this time looking at particle properties and how you can use them to change your particle's appearance. So let's jump in. Okay, so now let's take a look at particles, starting with the properties. First of all, let's just delete these sparkles just by choosing delete particle type and twirl open petals. Particles have their own properties, which you use to change the overall appearance of the particle. The first is shape image. So if I just click on the image here, this opens up the particle shape editor. And you can choose from a wide variety of different shapes, or you can import your own shape. Notice how the particle that we're using for the petal actually has 5 frames. It says 1 of 5 here. And if I click the arrow, you can see each of the different frames. So there are various multi-frame shapes, and they're indicated by this red play icon. And you can see use single frame is actually checked, and random start frame is checked. Let me just uncheck those. And these are specific to multi-frame particles. Now we probably won't see much difference because these are falling way too rapidly. So let me just drop the weight right down. Okay, so now you can see it's actually cycling through all of the 5 frames. And you might prefer that look. It actually does give the particles more of a sense of 3D-ness. By clicking on Use Single Frame, though, it's only going to use the first frame of those 5 frames. So there's less variation, but if you choose a random start frame, then it's going to choose one of those 5 frames at random for each particle. So that gives you more variation, but not quite the dramatic motion that not using single frame gives you. MIP mapping is to do with the aliasing of the particles. If you use a particle type that has slightly aliased edges, then turning on Use MIP mapping can soften that. Otherwise, just leave this unchecked. The intense option won't really show much with these particles. It's actually going to make them black and white. Let me just check that. You can actually see what the intense is doing. When particles are overlapping, we get this brighter area. But for colored particles, it makes them black and white. Let me just uncheck that and just change the particle type. Once again, just to a basic blur. And I'll also need to change the color. So just come down to colors. And for the intense to work, you need to choose a fairly muted color. Let me just choose this muted orange and apply. And now if I check intense, you can see we get these much brighter areas where the particles are overlapping. If I did choose a brighter orange, you're going to see very little result. Not too bad with that one, actually. That looks pretty good. What about this red, really saturated? See how we're losing that effect altogether. So the color that you choose definitely will have an effect on the intense option. The preserve color option is there to help keep really intense particles from adding to white and preserving some of their original color. Single particle, when checked, will create a single particle connected to the emitter's position. And you can use attach to emitter when you want particles to move with the emitter, but you don't want just a single particle. This is not going to have really any effect on this particular setup. I just checked that though. You can see we get an attach amount, and this controls how particles move with the emitter. 0 means that no particles will move with the emitter, and 100 means that all particles will move with the emitter. Just going to keep that unchecked. Let's take a look at behavior. Behavior is the category where you can set the particle angle. Let's just change the shape image. Choose something that will make a little more sense with angle. Just going to come into sampler and choose this A and click apply and uncheck intense. Let's see, they're a little large, so I'm going to change the size. And also, I want to remove the spin variation. And there's no spin and no motion randomness. That's good. So the default particle angle is random. There's also an align to motion option. And that basically means that the particles are aligned to the initial velocity of the emitter, and you specify the align angle. At the moment, align angle is zero. Let me just drag that. And you can see I can change the angle. The keep align to motion option is important when particles change direction, for example, when they're being affected by forces. And keep in mind that when this option is checked, the particle spin parameters will be overridden. The final parameter in behavior is use emitter emission. And when checked, this particle type uses the emitter emission angle and emission range parameters. And the third particle angle type is specify. And when you set this angle, all of the particles of this type will be created at the same angle. And this option isn't affected by the particle's initial motion. Okay, so next let's take a look at colors. But first of all, let's just change the shape image. It's going to come up to abstract and come down to the bottom here and choose heart 2. All right, so I need to make a few adjustments to this. First of all, let's see, the particles are falling down. I want them to rise upwards. So probably the quickest way to do that would be just to grab the line emitter and just bring it down all the way to the bottom. You can see it's emitting from both sides. So if I just zoom in, there we go, they're moving upwards now. The angle's slightly wrong. I'll leave it on specify, but just change that angle. So they're rising as you would expect. Okay, that's looking good. Maybe add a little bit of spin variation. Just a touch. Not too much. Maybe about 5. That's looking good. Okay, so change the size. Oh, that's way too large, isn't it? Let's see, probably about there, and size variation. First of all, actually, let's just change the number. There's too many particles. That's better. Maybe just increase the size a little bit. Yeah, that's good. And size variation. So a few smaller ones, a few bigger ones. That's looking good. They're kind of clumpy at the bottom. It's going to move that emitter way down so we don't see that clumpiness. That's good. Now we do need to have a few more frames preload. So I'll just increase that so it fills the frame up. Imagine you might be using this for a background. Okay, that's looking pretty good. So let's take a look at the color. Obviously we don't want these pale orange hearts. Want something a bit more vibrant. So I'm going to click on the color swatch here and create a gradient. On the first stop, I'm going to use a red. And on the last stop, just click to create that. Double click and choose a pale pink. And maybe a hot pink in the middle. I mean, like, maybe something like that. Well, that's a bit too hot, that one. Maybe that one. That one there. Okay. So the default color type is random gradient. So these hearts are being colorized from a random color from this gradient. If I only wanted to use the three key colors, I can select Use Key Colors Only. And that colorizes those only using those three colors. So there's much less subtle variation in the color. There's also an option for full gradient. And full gradient is going to colorize the particles from red at their birth through to this light pink at their death. We can't quite see them at their birth, but if I drag that up, you can see that they are red as they're being born, and as they come up to the top, they change to this light pink, which is a nice look as well. There is a repeat option, so I can have them go from red to hot pink to light pink and cycle back from red to hot pink to light pink, depending on how many repeats I've set. There's also an option for next key color, and this creates a number of particles which you set under number of each color for each of the key colors. I generally, though, tend to use random gradient, and if I want something a little more vibrant, use key colors only. So I am going to leave that one checked. Looking good. Next we have alpha, and alpha controls the opacity of the particles over their life. If we look at this particular setup, it's white at the beginning, then it fades out to black at the end. That means the particles are going to be fully opaque as they're born, and they'll fade out to transparency or full transparency towards the end of their life. Let's just change this a little bit. We'll just double click this first stop and make this black by dragging this all the way to the left and drag the second stop up. And you can't actually move this particular stop, so if you wanted to add more black here, just click to create another one and just make that one black as well. So you can see what's already happening. The particles now are transparent when they're born, fully transparent, and we just press play. And they fade up as they're rising up. So that gives a little more gentle look as well. Not so obvious with this line emitter that's outside the viewable area. Under alpha type, you can choose to link to color, and this is going to use the colors gradient to control the opacity. One other thing to note under full gradient is the repeat option. If I just increase that slightly, we'll get a flickering look to the particles, which is quite nice as well. I might leave that on, but just drop it down to 3. You can download Particle Illusion standalone for free at boriseffects.com, including thousands of free particle emitter presets. Continue watching this Getting Started tutorial series to learn more about what you can do with Particle Illusion and find out more about the plugin version of Particle Illusion with extra features, including built-in Mocha motion tracking at boriseffects.com.